In and
is being recorded.
There's nothing like the present in terms of getting our conversation started. So I'm sure more people will be logging in. And first of all, I want to welcome everyone into Harvard Hockey's first town hall of the spring. And I really appreciate everyone joining us when I know there's so much going on in your lives and you could be so many different places at this time. But my name is Chuck Hughes, for those of you who don't know me. I'm class of 92 and was lucky enough to be part of that national championship team. But more recently, I've been serving as the co-chair of the Friends of Harvard Hockey. And talking with the men's and women's coaches, we thought it would be great to bring the community together during this COVID time and get a chance where we don't often have the opportunity to talk to people who are, A, super busy, you know, particularly in the world of the NHL, seem to be working from, late August until June, and the opportunity to get engaged with our Harvard Hockey family is rather limited. So welcome to tonight's first town hall with four terrific, five, if you count our coach Donato, five terrific panelists who are part of the NHL. And before I get rolling and turn it over to our master of ceremonies, Trip Tracy, class of 96, I wanted to just give people a few background. Microphones will be muted during this conversation, so you won't have the opportunity to chime in. But in the format of the program, we are going to be having a Q&A portion in the last 20 minutes or so. So there's a chat section where if you share your questions, Trevor and I will forward them and get them to Trip, and Trip will select some questions that he'll ask to the panel along the way. So, that's sort of the format here. We hope you enjoy hearing from these incredible people. And then one final pitch, of course, many of you come to the Friends tonight through being a past participant of the Friends of Harvard Hockey, but we're a unique group in which, we fund somewhere between 20-25% of the annual men's and women's hockey budget. So a quick plug for the Friends that if you've been a donor and a giver, thanks so much. And if you haven't and you're interested, you can always go to the Go Crimson website, and in the top right corner of the athletics page, make a decision to contribute to the hockey programs. And it's surely appreciated, because the one thing that our players, whether they go on to play in the NHL and go off into careers in finance or medicine or law, they all leave saying that they had a great experience both, in the classroom and down at the rinks. And we want to make sure that we're able to continue to do that. So without further ado, I'm going to step into the background and I'm going to pass the torch to my partner in crime, though 4 years my younger, Trip Tracy, who's goaltender here at Harvard and had a terrific career, class of 96. Trip was a history major and a standout goaltender who helped lead the Crimson to a Final Four in 1993-94. He played 3 years of minor league hockey before turning his attentions to the broadcasting world. And today, Trip currently serves as a television and radio commentator for the Carolina Hurricanes. And Ted reminded me that The Athletic recently did a survey that voted you and your partner, John Forslund, as the number one television commentating crew in the NHL. So kudos to you for that. And, despite me having served as your goaltender coach for your senior year of college, I think you turned out all right, Trip. So without further ado, I'm going to pass it over to you. And thank you so much for offering to lead this panel discussion tonight, Trip.
Chucky, thank you so much. And, a quick thank you and a heartfelt thank you to Chucky, of course, the winning goaltender in the 89 National Championship win over Minnesota, to Trevor McDonald for putting this all together. This is a great privilege for me. I'm in Michigan right now. My mom's off camera. She's so fired up about this. She's got her Harvard Varsity Club hat on. My classmates and teammates, certainly that are tuned in, will enjoy the fact that I'm here in the library, because anybody that knew me in my 4 years, it was like pulling teeth to get me out of Widener. We only have so much time, and this is a fantastic, ultra accomplished panel, and I'd like to just start by introducing everybody to make sure you're all there, because we're scattered throughout the country. And I'm going to start with our very, very fine head coach, at Harvard since 2004-2005. Teddy Donato was the MVP in the Final Four in beating Michigan State and Minnesota. He had a very fine and long-standing NHL career and has now got Harvard for a long period of time on the right track. Like me, he was a history major. He was at Kirkland. Coach, are you there right now?
Thanks, Tripp. Thanks for the introduction. I guess, first off, I want to say how excited I am, as he should be, as I look at my screen. Right drop, right in the middle of my screen is Coach Clary. So, Coach, I know you will struggle a little bit health-wise, but it's still great to see you. I love to see you smile. I love the fact that you can't bite the back of my legs or fake handshake anybody on Zoom. You know, great to see you. But, I just want to say that I'm, you know, very privileged to be able to follow, you know, so many great people in this program. And, you know, I think tonight I'll certainly bounce in. But tonight, me really a chance to listen to some of our great alums. You know, we have so many of them. Tonight we chose to take some in the hockey world, but obviously we have many and many different facets of life. So you know, it's really, you know, it's quite an honor. And my night's already made to be Coach Cleary, and you know, I see Bill Fitzsimmons over there, the great goalie, and head of admissions at Harvard. I know I see Tim Barakat and Phil Falcone and Ken Cohn and so many others, Bob Anderson, and you know, so many guys that have been so incredibly generous to the program, and there's so many others. I don't want to take up our whole time thanking people. But thank you guys all, and I'm excited as well to listen to some of our esteemed panelists.
Daddy, boy, that is fabulous news. You should have seen the smile on my mom's face when she heard the greatest of the great, Coach Cleary, is on the Zoom tonight. We're going to get to, boy, the impact he's made on all of our lives, both at Harvard and since then, in a minute. But I want to continue because, Teddy, you told me offline yesterday, because your team, since you became the head coach, you play with pace, you attack, but I think you also play with grit. And you pointed to those ingredients from when you won a national championship with Coach Cleary. And there's a guy in the NHL who's had a tremendous managerial career that in his, you know, right now is the president and general manager of the Philadelphia Flyers, Chuck Fletcher. Until the league was suspended, had the Flyers playing with those major components, one of the big stories in the league. He was the class of 89, like me. He lived in Elliott. We've become, I'd like to think, great friends. Chuck, you can disagree if you want, over the years. He helped to put together a Stanley Cup championship team in Pittsburgh with Ray Sherrill in 2009. Other stops in places like Anaheim. Minnesota was an annual playoff team in contention when he was the general manager there. What a job he's done with Philadelphia. Chuck, how are you? How are things going in Philly right now?
Going pretty well, Tripp. Just getting used to the new normal, working from home every day. The kids are both back from college, finishing classes online, and we still all like each other after about 6 weeks. So far it's been pretty successful.
Well, you have thick skin. I've tested that over the years and some of our times bonding together. I want to move forward just because we can ask as many questions and maximize the time. So I'll go chronologically in age. And oh my gosh, what a year. What a year Alex Killorn was having when the NHL suspended play. 26 goals. No question he was going to eclipse 30. You know, you look at what he's done in crunch time when Tampa's gone deep in the playoffs. He's always been a guy that elevates his play. He won a Calder Cup championship. Norfolk, it looked like he got better and better each of his 4 years playing for Ted, playing for Harvard. His senior year was his best year. He was a member of the first team ECAC selection. He's kind enough to join us tonight. The pride of Dunster. He lived in Dunster. Alex, are you there? Live from Tampa.
Yeah, I'm here. I don't know if you could hear me or not. Trevor said my thing wasn't sounding good, but I'm happy to be here. Happy to talk and get this thing going.
Yep, we hear you loud and clear, Alex. And finally, boy, talk about a guy that hit the ground running both as a freshman at Harvard and now as a freshman, a rookie in the National Hockey League. Adam Fox, boy, get this. Three times in 3 years, the first team All-American for the Harvard Crimson. And I can tell you, as the Rangers, pains me to say it, won all four games in the season series against the Hurricanes. I put Adam Fox's contribution in those four games right there with Panarin and Mika Zibanejad. I do, Adam and I talk offline and enjoying each other's company the last couple of days. I do have to say this, because I'm a Caniac and a long, 21 years with the Hurricanes, 22 as a player in the organization. At the world famous Luau get together every spring, if I could have convinced Adam Fox to come to the blue skies of Carolina, I probably would have been convinced to eat 25 goldfish at that great festive get together every spring. That's another story into and unto itself. He's in New York. Adam, are you with us? It's great to have you if you are.
Yeah, thanks. I don't know if you want the Caniacs to hear you saying good things about me, but definitely happy to be here and get started.
Well, your play this year, stellar. And my gosh, I just looked. I mean, for the last 25 games, you were playing well over 20 minutes a night. No, Adam, I'm going to stick with you for the first question. And I don't know if everybody that's joined us tonight knows that in these atypical circumstances that Teddy Donato had a decision to make with the team party that's around this time, the banquet, and he elected to do it. I heard it was superb. Your senior class, you were part of it along with John Marino, who had a good year with the Pittsburgh Penguins. That was Monday night. I know how excited Coach Donato was to have you. Can you paint a picture of what it was like to be with your classmates? And I'm sure it was a special night.
Yeah, it was awesome for me. Obviously, a little different perspective for me, leaving a year early and not being there for, senior year with my class. So it was definitely fun to be back and, hear all the guys talk and, see you guys get awards and just be a part of that. And, it was obviously disappointing for them the way, their season ended and everything. But, just being there and hearing the guys talk and, seeing them was nice for me. And, we talked a lot about, Harvard and how you make connections and, it's kind of, a bigger family with, alumni and all that. So just being there and, catching up with everyone was definitely fun.
Yeah, Teddy, Coach Donato talked about how fantastic that night was, and it was, and you were a huge part of that. Alex, shifting back to you, and you and I spoke this morning about Coach Cleary, and maybe if you could just tell everybody what we talked about, because both as a member of the Harvard Crimson for 4 years, and even all these years with Tampa now. You guys have a great relationship. You even saw him recently. Can you tell everybody what you told me this morning? Because I thought it was really cool.
Well, I think Teddy kind of alluded to it before when he said, Bill Cleary got into the chat. But I know during my 4 years at Harvard, he was there quite a bit. I know he would watch us play all the time. He'd always have advice or constructive criticism, whatever it may be. But I remember I went to a game against St. Lawrence right before the quarantine happened. And as I was walking out of the arena, someone came and, grabbed at my Achilles and started barking like a dog. And I was like, wow, he still got it. So, yeah, he's been great. And he told me he's been watching. And I've talked to him here and then. So I'm happy to hear he's doing well.
Yeah. And it was mentioned earlier, he has that deep play. I've never seen more of a wandering finger on the Coach Cleary handshake. No doubt about it. I just think about the impact that you've made in all your different spots as a manager, now as also as the president of the Philadelphia Flyers. Now, when you were at Harvard, Coach Cleary was coaching, and then he shifted to being an athletic director. Is there anything you took from – I guess your time observing him that has served as a beneficial asset to the way that you've managed for all these years in the National Hockey League?
Coach Cleary was ahead of his times, and you know, Ron Tomasoni was there with him at the time, and Kevin Hampe was helping out a lot. Mark Fusco was actually helping out a lot back then too. It was really a lot of tremendous people, but Coach Cleary was way ahead of his times. I mean, back at that time, the NHL was a little bit more station to station, a lot of dump and chase. And Coach Cleary was always about speed and puck movement and puck support all over the ice. And I thought he was always ahead of his time as a head coach. And Harvard for those years, when I was there in the late 80s, we were a top program and obviously won the national championship, lost the national championship, won a lot of hockey games, a couple Hobey Baker winners. So it was a great program, did a great job recruiting, but I think he made everybody better. And a lot of those players went on and played pro hockey, and including Teddy.
You know, Chuck, just to follow up, you know, at that time, Teddy, you know, went on and he played over 700 games and had a pretty darn productive career. But, you know, it was tough for Harvard players to make the National Hockey League. Maybe it was perception back then. And, you know, Ted and I were talking yesterday, since he became the coach 2004-2005, Chuck, there have been 16 players that have played in the National Hockey League. And when you look at the recent numbers, those numbers, and they're very impressive ones, should only go up. I mean, the freshman class this year, 5 of the 7 players were drafted in the NHL. So you're the perfect guy to ask. You know, if you were to, you know, to talk to the 31 general managers and their scouting staffs, how has the perception for the good of Harvard players of taking the next step, of making an impactful contribution in the National Hockey League changed over the last many years? Because right now it seems to be cooking.
Yeah, I think back in the 80s was even, it goes back well before then, there was a bias, I think, against college players and even American players in some sense. The game has obviously changed. It's less than 50% Canadian now. Many more players are coming through the NCAA. I think most NHL teams recognize that unless you're an elite player, maybe a Patrick Kane, a John Toews, and even John Toews went to college. But a lot of those guys can maybe go 1 or 2 years. They can maybe play junior hockey because they're ready to play at 19 or 20. Most kids need a little more time. And you go to college, you get an education, you're well-rounded, get a chance to practice and train. And Harvard does a great job. I mean, Teddy's done an unbelievable job recruiting. And you're right, even this year, we're talking about several kids that are on their way to Harvard, talking about several kids for this year's draft that are on their way to Harvard again. It's a pipeline, and I think what Teddy's found is he's got a successful model, and when you're successful building a program and you win, players want to go, and they see you can get a great education, get drafted, and go on to a pro career, much like Alex and Adam had done. So it's self-sustaining now, and that's a real credit to everybody, but certainly Teddy's at the front of that.
Boy, it's a very, very exciting times, Chuck. Teddy, coach, you know, these two very, very fine players that we have with us tonight. Again, you and I speaking yesterday. What a compliment. You played with Adam Oates, who some people would consider as fine of a mind as there's ever been in the National Hockey League. You said in a lot of ways Adam Fox has a mind, a hockey IQ like Adam Oates. I'd love to hear you speak to that. And then how proud you are of Alex Killorn and, you know, really the way he took it to another level. His senior year and how that's paid dividends for him now that he has really had a consistently good NHL career, coach.
Yeah, well, I think, even talking to Coach Cleary about this, you know, you see the value in the 4 years for Alex. I thought, you know, he came in with, you know, a very talented guy, but I thought he got much stronger throughout his 4 years and he really diversified his game. He was a great offensive player when he showed up. You know, he really learned how to be a more well-rounded player and killed penalty for us. And not only was he out there when we needed a goal, but when we were up a goal late in the game. And I think, you know, we talked about the opportunity to maybe break in as a guy that could, you know, be sound defensively. And, you know, so great to see him this year having such a big year, 26 goals. You know, I think they're still the odds-on favorite for me in my mind to be the Stanley Cup champs. And I would I'd be very happy for Alex. But, you know, the great part about the guys on our panel tonight, you know, whether it be Alex or Foxy or Fletch, is these guys are true friends of the program. Anytime, you know, anybody picks up the phone and asks any of them, they're always so gracious with their time. And, you know, to me, that once again comes back to the culture of giving back that was put in place so many years ago by guys like Coach Clary and Jack Reardon. And, you know, and so to me, you know, that's really the tradition that we're trying to carry on, is to make sure we leave the jersey in a better place. And, you know, the guys on the panel tonight are really guys that we're very proud of.
Teddy, you did the exact same thing, because if you talk to the guys in my 4 years, from Teddy Drury, Matt Mulgrave, right on down to my classmates, Jason Karamanis, Kirk Nielsen, when you were a Boston Bruin, you came back and you spent time with us. So you did it too. Alex, I have to tell you, I talked to, because I remember when you first broke in the NHL and on the road in Raleigh, you'd always sit next to Hall of Famer Marty San Luis in the locker room. You guys were and are very good buddies, aside from being teammates. And he said to me, he said, Alex Killorn, and it's a growing role now, and he, you know, he expected it from you the year that you've had this season. But he said two things. He said he's always been acceptant of the role that you've given him on the team. And then he said what he liked most about you, and I think this is important about locker room culture. He said you could carve Alex or he could carve you, but if you went right back at him, he could take it. I think that's really important to chemistry. Wish we had all the time in the world to go into that, because some guys have phyllo skin. Alex, talk about what Teddy spoke about and really making your game complete, because it certainly has gained the recognition and the admiration from Marty St. Louis, just that.
I just unmute myself. For myself personally, like Teddy was saying, when I came into Harvard, I mean, I don't know if you would say it, but I don't know if I would have ever made the NHL after those first 2 years. I just wasn't ready. I wasn't the player I needed to be to become an NHL player. I think my game defensively developed a ton at my time at Harvard. I learned how to use my players on the team with me to become a better player. But once I got to the NHL, I feel like, well, my only coach really in the NHL has always been John Cooper. He's been my coach for, I think, 9 years now. But I think right from the get-go, he felt like he could rely on me defensively. So it just gave me a chance to play more in situations that young guys typically don't get those opportunities. So just being on the ice more gave me confidence. And I think that leaked into my offensive game, because the more you play, the more confidence you get. That typically translates into better stats and team play, whatever you want to call.
And plus 78 in your career. Plus 78. Get a load of that. Let that marinate.
Yeah, that's probably more than team minus, played on.
I tell you, it's a pretty good night. Adam Fox, you're plus 22 as a rookie. Everybody talks about the way you move the puck and you distribute it, I think, already at an elite level. But plus 22 in your rookie season. And then talking to David Quinn, I know that he is totally confident, your coach with New York, of using you in a shutdown capacity. So whoever, whether it be Alex Killorn and Tampa coming in, whoever David Quinn thinks is the top line on the other team, why do you think you've been able to hit the ground on the defensive side of the puck in the NHL? And if you had to pick one guy so far that's been the toughest to defend, who would it be?
Yeah, I think for me, you know, people always look at, you know, me being a small defender and, you know, think offense. And, you know, I think that's obviously a big part of my game, but, you know, still got to play defense as a defenseman. And I think I just try and use my hockey sense more than anything to help me. I think that's, you know, I'm not really overpowering many guys or, you know, knocking people to the ground. But, you know, if I could take the puck away from them, it's just as, you know, useful for me. So obviously, you know, took some time to, you know, maybe earn Coach Quinn's trust, you know, coming in as a rookie and, you know, one who's being known for offense, it, you know, obviously was a focal point for me to, you know, show him that I could defend and, you know, try to do that as best as I could. And I guess, you know, obviously the top guys are always the toughest. You know, I'm not always out there too much against like McDavid and stuff, but those guys are pretty hard to defend. Him, you know, MacKinnon and Ovechkin, those are probably, you know, up there with some of the tougher guys to stop.
A follow-up, Adam. You know, Teddy was telling me that, you know, because a lot of guys I know, and I say this humorously, in the NHL these days, you know, they go home and they don't have the center ice package. They're not watching. And Teddy Donato said you would always have the book on every player. So, number one, if you were playing Alaska Fairbanks, would you know all four lines and all three sets of D? And your first tour of the NHL, would you know the same, say, if you're playing Anaheim, you know, on a Monday night?
I might know Anaheim a little better than Fairbanks, but, you know, I think just growing up, I was a big hockey fan and, you know, loved to watch. And, you know, now being in it, it's, you know, a decent amount of the same people grew up watching. So I think in that sense, you know how people play a little bit, but I think it's also just learning on the fly. You know, I think from game 70 as opposed to game 1 or 5, I, you know, took big strides and just kind of, you know, tried to adjust as I went. I knew it would be, you know, a bit of a learning curve. And, you know, I think just adapting along the way was important for me.
It's cool. Chuck, I was lucky enough when I had my first training camp as a player, Jim McCrossin was the head trainer and strength and conditioning coach with the Hartford Whalers back then. He's your guy in Philadelphia. He has supreme experience. And what I want to ask you, over your years, Florida, Anaheim, Pittsburgh, Minnesota, so I'm sure a lot of the Harvard players are watching and young hockey players tonight, how has off-season and in-season training changed the most? And what are the things, Chuck, that Jim McCrossin with the Flyers would really magnify and try to focus on right now in a time like this when you can't be on the ice?
Yeah, well, it's really changed since the 80s and probably by the 90s, guys started learning more about their bodies. But I would say now guys don't even get out of shape. Maybe at the end of a season, you take a few weeks and relax, go on vacation, but they never let themselves go. And you know, when I first started, guys would basically use training camp to get in shape. It was 4 or 5 weeks. It was about 5 or 6 weeks, sorry, back then. And you'd play your way into shape. And even the first 20 games of the season were painfully slow. But guys are in great shape. Right now, it's tough. I mean, people probably don't have access to gyms. Maybe some of the NHL guys in their homes have some home gyms that they use. But a lot of body weight and a lot of, you know, circuits and just whatever you can do, you know, bands and push-ups and pull-ups and for a lot of guys. But it's a different era right now. And it's going to be interesting if we are able to come back and play this year, because most players haven't skated. And maybe some of the Europeans, I think some of the Swedes are able to skate, but most guys don't have access to ice. And this may be one of the few times where we come back to a training camp where guys really haven't skated. So it's going to be different for everybody. And, you know, particularly if we come back, say, the end of the summer, guys have been off 3-4 months. I don't know, maybe you could ask Alex and Adam. I can't imagine they've spent 3 months off the ice in their lives, or probably in 10, 15 years. So it's going to be a lot different for all these players.
Alex, I know you typically, you're in Tampa. Typically in a normal offseason, you train in Montreal. Have you done anything different in normal circumstances with your training in the offseason as your career has gone on? And what have you focused on during these unique circumstances?
Yeah, so I think as my career has progressed, you kind of find certain things that work. As the older you get, it's more becomes injury prevention than anything. You just kind of want to work for longevity. I know when I was at Harvard, I was really trying to get bigger and stronger. And typically you do that a little bit now at my age in the summer, but really it's just kind of making sure you're feeling as good as possible going into training camp. I know some training camps I've been doing 350-pound front squats in my back. I couldn't feel my back. So it's something you learn over time. And it's just about being comfortable, you know, getting physio and all that special stuff done. But during this quarantine, like Chuck was saying, I have a home gym. So luckily, I've been able to work out at home. The closest thing I have to skating is like these Mars Blade rollerblades that they give us, and I just kind of rip around my house, but and outside, there's nothing really that you can do that imitates skating. I know even when guys get back to training camp after skating all summer, they'll be like, you know, I still have to play 4 or 5 exhibition games to really feel like I'm in shape. So it's going to be different, but everyone other than the Swedes are in the same boat. So we'll see.
Hedman's going to have another advantage.
yeah,
seriously. Adam, what have you been doing?
He ain't skating.
Adam, what have you been doing, pal?
Yeah, I'm just kind of the same thing. You know, I don't have a pair of rollerblades, but just been trying to work out and, you know, treat this a little bit like, you know, the off season when the season ends. And, you know, when we were at school, they would take out the ice for 3 weeks to a month. So, you know, this is a little longer than that, but just trying to focus on, you know, treating it a little bit like an off season and trying to get stronger. And, you know, hopefully if there's a training camp, then get the skating back. But just right now, just trying to work out as much as I can.
We talk about the physical part of it, guys. You know, we're going to take some questions here in a second. But, Teddy, one question for you, Coach, because you have that unique identification advantage that you know what it's like to be an NHL player, you know what it's like to be a college player, and you can apply both of those things to being a coach. How different is it with your ability to prepare for games and focus on the task at hand the day of a game in college when you might have some classes, which is your first priority, and then when you're a full-time player in the NHL? And how have you, I guess, kept that in mind with the way you approach your guys at the collegiate level?
Yeah, it's a good point. You know, I think, you know, while you're a student, I think your freshman year, at least when I was there, that was the toughest. You know, you just kind of get thrown into a new environment and juggling that, and then just the realization that, you know, that final exams were the Super Bowl for everybody was a little bit of a new, you know, thought process I had to get used to. But I think, you know, the same way you prepare in college is the same way you prepare in the National Hockey League. You know, and I think for us, I think the challenge was, you know, for me, you know, trying to be your best every night, you know, trying to find that super high. Whereas maybe in college, you know, certainly the first 2 years, we had so many talented players, guys like, you know, Lane McDonald and C.J. Young and Alan Bourbeau and Peter Savagula, so many great players, Mike Vukinich. So there were a lot of games that you could be okay and still end up with a few points. But certainly that wasn't the case as a pro. You had to, you know, try to bring your A game every night.
Okay, yeah, it's good stuff, Teddy. We're the first question from the audience, we're going to go to Chuck, and then Ted, ask you to answer as well. The last 4 or 5 years, more players are leaving early for the NHL. Why is this, and will the trend continue or ramp up? Chuck?
Well, it seems like, I guess it depends on the school. At Harvard, Teddy has done a good job of getting kids to come in and commit for close to 4 years almost all the time, which has been great for that program in terms of continuity. I just remember last year, it was a great group of kids at the U18 team in Ann Arbor, and many of them were even drafted in the first round. And I remember interviewing most of those kids, and they all said they wanted to go to school for 1 year and then turn pro. And you almost wanted to ask them, well, why are you going to school if you're going for 1 year? But I think it varies from kid to kid. But, you know, there's real money to be made, I guess, and certain kids are good hockey players. And you look at some of those kids in last year's under 18 team, and some of them aren't that far away from playing in the National Hockey League if they want to try. So, but it's a hard question to ask. I mean, again, Harvard's done a great job of having a lot of their kids stay for the full program and get their degree and then still be able to turn pro. But, you know, maybe it's a better question to ask Alex and Adam, because they went through the process and they play with kids that probably did leave early.
Yeah, let's do that. We have some more questions we got to get to, but Alex, you know, cause you made a decision to stay your senior year And I believe Steve Yzerman, the general manager of the time at Tampa, would have loved to have gotten you out. And your senior year was your best year. And maybe it's given you the type of pro career you've had in the NHL. Take us back to that decision. And it seems like you made the right one.
Yeah, well, I think it's different for every player. I know for myself, that fourth year was such a big part in me becoming a good pro player, just because I had a great year. I was All-American. And I came into the pro with, like, the most confidence I've ever had in hockey. And I jumped in to a Calder Cup team that had won 26 games straight. So, for me, it was the right decision. I just wasn't ready. I know I did talk with Steve Yzerman after my junior year. And some of it also comes from the team, right? Like, sometimes the team pushes the players out of college. Steve Yzerman told me, hey, if you want to finish your degree, I know that's important. I know that's why you went to Harvard. Go do that, and we'll have a contract waiting for you next year. So for me, I know I had that reassurance. And for me, I needed another year. I think I had a talk with Teddy too. And we talked about, you know, do I go struggle to battle in the NHL, or do I have a great senior year and set myself up for the best pro career?
Wow. Like I said, clearly you made the 1,000% correct choice, Alex. Adam, this comes from the audience. Can you share what the biggest transition, it's been pretty seamless, but what the biggest transition has been from Harvard to the pros in your rookie year?
Yeah, I think for me, just, you know, the pace, I think, you know, things obviously happen a lot quicker than at school. And I think for me, you know, I got kind of a little taste of that when I was able to go to the World Championships and see that there and, you know, practice and play against, you know, some of the top guys and, you know, going to the summer and knew what I had to work on. So that definitely helped with the transition for me. But I think, you know, just quicker decisions and, you know, obviously everyone's bigger, faster, stronger, but that's kind of an obvious thing there. But just, you know, the pace of play is, you know, definitely, you know, top notch.
Following up, my friend, another question for the audience for both you and Alex. So we'll stick with you first. Who has been the toughest? I hit on this earlier, and you mentioned Connor McDavid, among others. Who's been the toughest player to play against, and who's been the most exciting player to either play against or play with?
Well, definitely for me, playing with is Panarin. I think, you know, night in and night out, you could see how you could take over a game, and, you know, you might win a game 5-1, and, you know, you don't really notice him, and he has 4 points, and you know, he's all over the score sheet and could have had 7 easily. So I think, you know, playing with him is pretty cool. And, you know, I got to give a quick little shout out to Ryan Donato. He had, you know, a goal against us both times we played. So he's kind of a tough cover there. So, but definitely McDavid and, you know, those top guys. And, you know, our trip to Tampa didn't go too well. So they got a lot of guys that, you know, are tough to play against too.
Yeah, in the 4 games that the Canes had against you, I got sick and tired of that Panarin leg kick, I can tell you that. And Ryan Donato has a heavy shot like his dad. He had one against the Canes last year. Alex, what about you? Because you're a veteran at this point. Over the course of your career, you've gone to a Stanley Cup Finals. You just about won it. You won a President's Trophy with record numbers a season ago. Who's been the most exciting player that you played with? Who's been the toughest out over the course of your career?
Well, the toughest to play against, I mean, there's a couple, but if I had to pick one, it'd probably be McKinnon. Played with him at a World Championships, got to know him a little bit, so I got to see a little bit more of him. I think with him and McDavid might be a little bit quicker up the ice, but McKinnon will go through you. He's so powerful and he's so strong. I have so much respect for his game and how his game has progressed in his time in the NHL. Guys that I play with, it's got to be Nikita Kucherov. I've learned more in hockey, like little things, from Nikita Kucherov than I've learned from anyone else, because I play on the power play with him at the net front. I don't do anything, but he just shoots pucks through me. But just little things about where defensemen are placing their stick, or when someone crosses over this way to go, like little things that people that are watching the game don't really understand. I've learned a ton from him.
Gosh, that's really good stuff. I'd like to follow up on that, but I want to keep this thing rolling. And I've got a question to Coach Donato, and then to Chuck Fletcher. It would be great to hear ideas on how we get back on the ice to run safe practices if we are constrained in the fall. So from the collegiate perspective, Teddy, we'll start with you.
Yeah, it's a really, difficult question. I'm certainly not an expert. I am an optimist, so I'm hopeful that, that either we'll find a cure at some point or, a vaccine. But, I think that at this point, we may be able to take advantage that that our season starts a little bit later. And, we could possibly, between the morning and the afternoon, just divide guys up so there wasn't, a full team on the ice, but maybe some small groups. And, I guess the plus side is it would give everybody a great chance academically to get off to a great start, and then hopefully, we would be able to have a season. But, that's kind of the, way down the list of all the things that, that are being discussed. I'm certainly not an expert. I'm just, but I am the ultimate optimist. So hopefully things will return to some kind of normalcy.
Chuck?
Yeah, well, echoing some of what Teddy said, I mean, we're maybe a little bit different in pro hockey because we have the ability, assuming we can make it work, to potentially play in empty buildings and have the games televised. And that's what the Players Association and the NHL are talking about now, trying to find ways that we can get our teams back and keep them isolated from the general population and possibly even from our families and go into a bubble and test everybody all the time and play hockey for TV. But I mean, clearly going forward, that's not a sustainable way of running a business. I mean, we need our fans. And so probably have to hope for a vaccine, as Teddy said, or some sort of mitigation efforts that can help if people get it, that curtail the effects. But, we got a long road ahead of us here, I think, until we get fans back. But that's what we're hopeful. And possibly, late fall or something like that, we can start our season next year. And I'm sure it'll be the same for college athletics, for hockey, or for the minor leagues, for any of these leagues. We're all just hoping for something to break between now and then so we can safely get people back into the arena. But we seem to be a ways away from that right now.
Chuck, I got to follow up. This one's a beauty. This is for you and I. And the question for the audience is, can you talk about analytics and the role it is playing in the NHL today? Carolina has one of the most advanced metrics teams. Will teams invest more money into analytics? And does this model neglect the role of character and locker room fit in those analytics? Okay, so, and we have one of the best, if not the best, and Eric Tolsky, who was a Harvard grad. He lived in the Quad. I think a big part of, say, a guy that you had great times with in Minnesota, Nito Niederreiter, coming in and playing so well for the Hurricanes last year. They don't make the playoffs without it. But then, Chuck, I ask, a guy like Alex Semin, when we got him years ago, and I was one of the few that got along well, and I had the trust of Alex Semin, but he played brutal, to be nice. And I think he had tremendous analytics. I'm not exposed to the advanced statistics that you would be as a manager, but how do you quantify heart, culture, and chemistry, and all other intangibles, into all of the other great things that analytics bring?
Yeah, well, that's first of all, I think the data in hockey is getting a little bit more sophisticated. We're able to try to break down what each player is doing to impact the play much more than what we used to. It used to just be what the shot differential was when a certain player was on the ice. Now we can break things down a little bit more, scoring chances and the type of scoring chances, and try to see how a player maybe impacts this line or the level of competition he plays against. So the data is getting a lot better, and it's certainly a pretty important part of it. But we basically have three buckets. You have the data bucket that tells you about the player. You have what your scouts say. They go to the rink and they watch how a guy skates and how he plays, and they have their own opinion. And then the third bucket is what you try to do by interviewing the player, getting to know the player, doing research behind the scene, how well will you fit in the room? Because at the end of the day, the most successful teams are the teams where people get along, and you can make it as complicated as you want. You want the best players possible, but you need to have a good team. It's not always the most talented team that wins. It's the most talented team that plays together. And sounds corny, but it is everything. Everybody knows that. Everybody that's been in the dressing room knows that. So that's the third bucket. And you have to look at all three of them when you're making a decision. But the data portion is the thing that's come the furthest since I've been involved in the game. And it's remarkable how much more data we use now than even 5 years ago.
That's great stuff. Great stuff. Thanks, Chuck. For Alex, let's start with you and then to Adam. If you point to one skill you worked on every day that you think helped take your game to the next level in high school and in college and now the NHL, what would that one skill be? Alex?
One skill, I think it's something I still do, and I'll probably have to do quite a bit when the quarantine's over, is puck protection. I think you have to play to your strengths, and for me, that's something that I think I do well, and that's a reason why I get to play with some of the guys I play with, is that I can keep the puck a little bit longer, hold on to it, keep the puck in the offensive zone. So even, you know, before, after drills, I'll get our biggest defenseman, Braden Colburn, and just have him lean on me or push me around, and that's something I've always worked on consistently.
Good stuff. I've always thought that you have very noticeable deceptive speed, too. That's a big asset for you, just my own opinion as an analyst. Adam, what about you? Same question. If you point to the one skill that you worked on day in, day out, going back to high school.
Yeah, probably for me, it's skating, I think. Growing up, I wasn't the best skater or fastest skater. I had, decent edges, but I thought it was something that, I could really work on to, kind of take my game to another level. And, something that, I still try and work on. And, I think comes with also, leg strength and all that, but just, working on my stride over the summers and, trying to do some extra work with our skating coach and skills coach after practice to, work on it. I think it's something that, obviously constantly keep improving on.
That's good stuff. Do you think, Adam, quickly, do you think that, because you have hockey sense, do you think hockey sense, when you look at rosters, the way that you pay attention to other NHL teams, do you think hockey sense is something you're born with or you can develop? And if you can develop it and improve it, what are the things that you can do to do so?
Yeah, I think definitely a good chunk. It's natural. I think some of it's, just seeing things naturally, but you definitely could improve it. I think, for a lot of guys watching film and, seeing mistakes you made and what was open and what was there and, maybe practicing stuff that you see and you can improve on. So I think that definitely helps. But, I think there's a good chunk of it that is just as natural. And but I think for someone trying to work on it, I think just watching film and watching other guys, and the top guys usually have pretty good hockey sense and make pretty good decisions. So I think just looking at them and seeing what they do could help too.
Cool. Teddy? Well, I've had the pleasure through the years. This is why hockey's the greatest game on earth too. Meet a lot of your teammates from all your different spots in the NHL. This question is for you, and they all love you. So for Coach Donato, outside of Boston, what was his favorite city in terms of different teams that you played for?
Well, I would probably say Anaheim, just because I hadn't had the chance to play in a warm weather city, and just to kind of see the Western Conference in a little bit different way. We also had, Paul Kariya and Timo Solani, a couple of pretty good players to watch every day. So that was nice. I would say Anaheim and Dallas. I played in Dallas with guys like Mike Modano and Brett Hull, Yuri Lettinen, Sergei Zubov, some great, great players. And I think that's the, that's just a blessing of being able to play at that level and really appreciate some great players and great teammates.
Well, and speaking of Anaheim, was the great Teddy Drury, was he on those Anaheim teams when you were there?
I think Teddy and I crossed over in in Anaheim and maybe with the New York Islanders as well. But Teddy's obviously was a tremendous player, you know, first class guy all the way. And, you know, we need to thank him every day for sending his son Jack, because, you know, kept the tradition of just world class character, you know, people that that are tremendous athletes. So we're so happy to have Jack, and we appreciate Teddy for everything he's done over the years. He's married to the, you know, to the great Liz Berkery of Harvard Women's Lacrosse National Championship fame. So just a real first family in Harvard athletics.
I always called Liz Tony the Tiger. And I'll tell you, Ted, when I was a freshman, Ted Drury would come back from the Olympics. He took us to the Spaghetti Club, the freshman class. I remember Michelle Breestroff, who died in the TWA crash, God rest his soul, was there at dinner, and he immediately made freshmen feel included. I'll never forget that. We tried to pass that along. We always had issue. I hope when you play with him in the NHL that he had lost his habit of essentially stretching in the nude, but that story is for another day. It really hurt our focus. But I don't want to get off track. I'm going to stick with you, Teddy. For each panelist, I want you to share with us a favorite memory away from the hockey rink.
Well, I guess I could I'd start with Chuck. Chuck and I were members at the DU. He was the president of the DU. So I was a sophomore, and you know, Chuck was the you know, was the president. So he kind of ran the show, but just a great guy. Anybody that's known Fletch, you know, would say the same thing. He's just an incredibly guy, you know, great guy, always upbeat. So we certainly had a lot of laughs back then. I'm sure at my expense, but that was still okay. And then, you know, Alex, I think for me, one of the things that was interesting was to see how he responded when Louis LeBlanc, you know, showed up. And Louis, you know, from the same general area, Lac St. Louis guy up in Montreal. And you could see them find a level of competition that was good for both of them, that kind of pushed each other. And I really do think that it made both of them better. But, you know, and I thought that Alex, you know, was able to help Louis get out of his shell a little bit as a freshman. He was a little bit on the quiet side, you know, and then Foxy, you know, it's, you know, he's just a, you know, super low key guy. I know my favorite saying of about Foxy, was something you know, they used to talk about at the draft. And he said, you know, I'll tell you what kind of guy Adam Fox is. He's the kind of guy that if your flight's going down, he'd order a martini. So I think that's, you know, that's Foxy. Just, you know, never too high, never too low, you know, very, makes it look so easy. You know, quite oftentimes on the bench, you know, I would, you know, look down at the other defenseman and say, hey, that's not for you guys. Don't try that at home. He's just a great guy and a great teammate. And, you know, as much as it was fun for him to be at our virtual banquet the other day, it was also, you know, I could tell the other guys in the team were very excited, especially some of the freshmen that, you know, probably looked forward to the opportunity to maybe play with him. For him to come on just shows the you know, the feelings he has for his classmates and his teammates. And, you know, it's not surprising coming, you know, from a guy like Adam.
Fabulous, Coach. Chuck, okay, you opened the door with the DU. I've heard rumors that you were like the guy that always was settled and complete composure in Animal House. What's your favorite memory away from the rink, off the ice? It's all yours.
I think Teddy's misremembering a lot of stuff, but no, has certainly had a little bit of fun there. A few other people may have been there as well, but no, everything was great there. I mean, I'm so old now, I have a hard time remembering a lot of stuff, but my rooming group, our senior year was pretty incredible. And just everything was just great about that year, just hanging out together and knowing a beer last year. And just a lot of great memories of friends that we still get together every year, Memorial Day, as long as my team isn't playing in the playoffs. And unfortunately, quite a few years we're not playing on Memorial Day, but we still get together every year now with our families, 50, 60 people every year. So it's incredible. So that's the thing I remember the most, is the people you meet when you're there.
This is cool. And I know at one point, Teddy Donato lived in Florida with some of your roommates from Harvard. And speaking of Florida, let's go back to Tampa. Alex, your favorite memory away from the rink?
My favorite memory away from the rink. I guess one that stands out is everyone's talking about the times that they've had with their roommates. I know my senior year, I was lucky enough to, one of my classmates' dad got us a house to live in off campus my last year. And we called it the Goat House, but it was a great house because guys have their final clubs and everything, but we would have the whole hockey team over, it seemed like at least once a week. And we have a great time. And I think that was a huge part in the chemistry of our team. I think when you think about Harvard and how it's grown over the years and how we've become a much better program, I think that my senior year when we went to the ECAC finals was definitely kind of a starting point in the growth of this program. So I attribute that to the Goat House.
I mean, no doubt. I mean, the proof's in the pudding. The proof's in the pudding. The watershed moment. Okay, let's go to Adam. Mr. Martini, your favorite memory away from the ring?
Yeah, mine's pretty similar there with, just always the first few weeks at school when, you know, the freshmen come on campus. I know, you know, my freshman year we had, you know, great seniors, the, you know, Alex Kerfoot and guys like that, that, you know, just made us feel pretty welcome right away. They set up a lot of events for us. And I think, you know, when I was there, it's something that we saw how much that helped the freshmen, you know, feel more comfortable. And I know for me, it, you know, made us seem like we were together for the whole year, just in those few weeks. So, you know, those events were always, you know, pretty fun for me. You got a little, you know, extra time before, you know, hockey started at the Ivy League schools. So those were always, you know, fond memories for me.
Okay. Before we get, Adam, love it. Before we get to our last question, I've been asked to answer that question, favorite memory away from the rink too. And mine would have to be with Coach Cleary, no doubt whether he's watching or if he wasn't. My senior year, things went great. Freshman year, won the Bean Pot. Sophomore year, went to the Final Four. Still think we had the team to win. Then things sort of fell off. And our senior year, I want to say, we were in the Valley. We lost 7 or 8 games, and I couldn't stop a beach ball. And we played St. Lawrence on the road in the first round, and they were the first seed, and we found a way to win. And I was living with Jason Karmanis, among my other great classmates and teammates, Jason, the very fine assistant general manager of the Pittsburgh Penguins, at Elliott House, no cell phones in those days. And we were between classes and the phone rang. And, you know, we picked it up and he wanted to talk to both of us, and it was Coach Cleary. And it was right after we got back from St. Lawrence, and I can't use the exact phraseology that he did. At least I think I can't. He told us that we played with phenomenal guts, and he said it better than that. And coming from a legend like Coach Cleary to make that call, Jason and I mean, we needed plastic surgery to remove the smiles on our faces. That's how much that call at Elliott House meant to the both of us. And when we ended that losing streak. Okay, final question, and Adam, we'll start with you. How has Harvard shaped your experiences in pursuing a career in hockey?
Yeah, I think for me, you know, when I first committed to Harvard, it was a pretty easy choice for me, just, you know, academically. But, you know, obviously the program grew a lot, and, you know, obviously Teddy had a big part to do with that. And he, you know, does a good job of getting guys just, you know, he has a good eye for talent, and guys want to go there and, you know, not just, you know, do everything they want to do academically, but also compete, you know, from a hockey perspective. And I think for me, you know, I was, you know, obviously given a really good opportunity there, and, you know, able to, you know, play my game and, you know, do what I could do, and was able to, you know, show myself. And, you know, it was obviously played a, a big part in helping me, you know, make the transition, you know, to the NHL. And, you know, obviously, you know, the hockey program there has played a big part in it for me.
Great stuff. Alex?
Yeah, for me, I mean, Harvard has been great, hockey-wise, academic-wise. I know when I first committed to Harvard, I wasn't sure on – I always wanted to play in the NHL. It would have been a dream of mine, but I think I was more of a realist back then, and I chose Harvard because I thought it would set me up better in life. And then once I got drafted, it became a reality, and the more I grew – not only did Harvard help me academically, but socially. You're in college for 4 years. You know, you gain a lot in that sense. I know talking to guys on my team now, guys that have made, you know, tens of millions of dollars or whatever, that went to junior, still regret that decision, just for the social part. You know, that's such a big part of your life, those years. And when you could do it, playing the best hockey, best college hockey, and getting the best education, it seems like too good of a situation to be true. So happy for my experiences there, and I wouldn't change it for anything.
Wow, this is making my night. Alex, superb. Chuck, what about you?
I mentioned it a bit earlier. I just, you know, going to Harvard, the players back then, and Teddy mentioned some of the players, but I started when Scotty Fusco and Tim Smith and, you know, Wayne McDonald, and you go right to the end, right up until the Teddy Drurys. I kind of touched on a lot of those players, but Coach Cleary just had a different way of seeing the game, and the way Harvard hockey team played was different than what I was used to watching my dad's pro teams over the years. And it really kind of changed the way I viewed the game. And you know, again, Coach Cleary was ahead of his time. I mean, Harvard was the fastest, arguably the most skilled team in college hockey back in the late 80s. And that's the way the game's gone to now. So it really had a huge, huge impact on the way I view the game and how I choose to build teams now. And it's amazing as it sounds. Here we are, whatever it is, 30 years later, and what Harvard was doing then is now the way everybody's doing it.
That's pretty cool. Very cool stuff, Chuck. Coach?
Yeah, I think I feel pretty similar to all three of the other guys. I think, you know, I guess when I came back to Harvard as the coach, you know, I didn't have to think very hard as to what I wanted our players' experience to be like. I wanted it to be exactly like the one Coach Cleary had set up for all of us. And that is a culture of trying to be excellent, you know, whether it was in school, whether it was on the ice, you know, and I think at the end of the day, for me, Harvard's about the people, and that's really how it's affected my life. I think going to Harvard, you know, being challenged, you know, academically taught me how to look at things honestly, even if I didn't like, you know, what the situation was. I had a kind of think about all the different, you know, causes for the results maybe I was getting, but I also think, you know, it's really the friendships and the people that you make, the friendships that you make and the people you meet. You know, just the other night, Thursday night, it's the third week since the pandemic has started that I've, you know, we've all got together, my college roommates, you know, and we're, you know, almost 25 years out here, and you know, just so great to see, you know, those guys and seeing how well they've done in all sorts of different areas of life. But you know, I think, you know, to me, Harvard's a special place, and it's special because the priorities are in the right spot, the perspective's in the right spot, and you know, there's many people on this call that. You know, that are incredible successes in so many different fields. And you know, I still think all these people would have been successes without Harvard, but I definitely think that Harvard helped them to have success because of some of the people they met and some of the ways they were challenged while at Harvard.
You know, the only thing that I would add to it, guys, you know, because you've said everything, is just that, you know, our parents that sacrificed so much to give us the chance to go to the country, the world's greatest university. And I, as I'm sitting here with my mom, you know, my dad, God rest his soul, I never saw my parents beam more than going to Harvard hockey games and the friendships they built, longstanding friendships with the parents of my teammates, not just in my year, but ahead of me, after me. I mean, you know, Ted, you mentioned Jack Drury, who I hope is a future Hurricane, because my mom and dad were so close with Ted and Liz Drury. You know, I held him at a wedding up north when he was, I think, several weeks old. That'll make it more special when he breaks into the National Hockey League. So the happiness that it gave our parents, if they were able to do so with work and finances and whatnot, to come around and watch us play. I know I never saw my parents happier in any other moment in hockey. So that I'm very grateful for that, and Harvard and the people. Is totally responsible for it. So, guys, Teddy, Chuck, Alex, Adam, thank you so much for doing this. It's been a ball for me. It's been a privilege. And as soon as we can get back on the ice safely, couldn't be prouder. Go Harvard, past, present, future.
Thanks so much for putting on the conversation this evening. And I want to thank the panelists again from the bottom of my heart. You guys are what makes Harvard hockey so great. And as you can see from this incredible panel and people who are on the call, we have leaders in education, leaders in finance. I think I'd be remiss to not give a shout out. I know that there are too many people to give a shout out, but Julie Rim was our manager for 3 years, who was part of the national championship team. And she served our country as a colonel in the Air Force, and she's a recently retired judge. And so I think people on this call understand, but the world should know, that the people who play Harvard hockey and are part of this organization can go off and have great careers in the NHL, and they can have great careers in their lives. And so I think this is what makes us all so proud to be part of the Harvard family, and continue all of your missions and continue to tell people and trumpet the Harvard cause. The final thing I'll say is thank you again, is that don't forget next Tuesday, May 12th, will be the Harvard Women's Town Hall that will feature four incredible Olympic players, plus Olympic coach, Coach Stone, Jen Botterill, three-time gold medalist on the Canadian Olympic team, Angela Ruggiero, AJ Malesko-Griswold, and Lindsay Fry. It should be phenomenal, and can't wait to talk about the first all-women's hockey broadcast in the NHL that happened this year as well. So thanks again for everyone participating. We hope you have a great night, and be well. Good night, everybody.